Good morning. Oh, good to hear you respond. Restrictions are lifted, so it's always good and encouraging to hear you answer back. Today we're going to hear a sermon on Psalm 23, which I find quite exciting. Who here, as soon as you say Psalm 23, who knows the psalm? All of you. All the hands should be up. The Lord is my shepherd. It is the darling psalm, or one of the darling psalms, one of the first recitals that I did as a young boy in primary school. How many here know Psalms 22 or Psalms 24? A couple? Oh, she does? Excellent. Because Psalm 23 is actually the second in a trilogy of shepherd psalms. In Psalms 22, and if you know the trilogy, it gives a lot more context and a lot more body. And I'd encourage you to go and do it as a study after today. In Psalms 22, we have the Good Shepherd referenced with John chapter 10, verse 11, the Good Shepherd who would lay down his life for us. Psalms 23, we have the Great Shepherd. Hebrews 13, verse 20 has a description of the Great Shepherd, great in his resurrection. And Psalm 23 talks about his greatness in his provisions and his protections over us, his guidance and his leading over us. And then the description as you read through Psalm 24, we find a reference of that description in 1 Peter 5, 4, the glorified chief shepherd, the shepherd of shepherds, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who will return one day crowned as King of glory, with many crowns to hand out to those who are worthy. So we've got the three G's. We've got the Good Shepherd, the Great Shepherd, and the glorified Chief Shepherd, symbolized by the cross in Psalm 22, the crook in Psalm 23, and not in a criminal sense, the crook of the shepherd's staff to lead and prod and pull and guide us, and the crown in Psalms 24, crowning with many crowns. May that be an insight and a blessing to just encourage you to look at those chapters further as we go from here today. But even though that sounds like a great sermon outline, 3 points, you'll be very glad to know that that is not my job. I will stick to singing. But we pray that that may be an encouragement to spur you on, and that it may be relevant in your life today. And all the songs today will be featured with those points. We encourage you to stand and sing with as much fervor and passion as you like. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love. Now all I know, your forgiveness.
we just sang, the psalmist says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be their shepherd and carry them forever." Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our strength, our portion, and our deliverer, Lord. Lord, this morning we praise you and adore you for who you are and all that you've been to us, Lord. Father, we commit this service into your hands. We pray that you will take complete control, and we pray that you will come and speak to us this morning. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Good morning. Welcome to church. What a great joy to be here as brothers and sisters in Christ on a Sunday morning, worshiping our Lord, lifting our voices. What a joy to lift our voices and praise our God. I wouldn't trade for anything else but to be here with my brothers and sisters on a Sunday morning. What a joy. And let's realize the depth of the importance of being in God's presence as fellow believers. So if you're new here, we are so glad you're here. We would like to welcome you. And if you haven't received a welcome bag as you walked in, please meet one of the welcomers in the green vest after the service, and they'll give you the welcome bag. Please fill in the welcome card, and if you can hand it over to the cafe, you get a free coffee or hot chocolate. And we would love to connect with you. We would love to get to know you more. So please do that. And at TBC, we would want to get deeper in connection, get deeper in community. We have various events happening through the week, through the month. Prayer groups, prayer meetings, life groups during the week. There are various activities for different age groups, playtime, connect kids, quench youth. So many things are happening in the life and ministry of the church. To know all those things, it's very important that we stay connected. So how do we stay connected? Please follow us on Facebook, follow the website, and we send a weekly newsletter every week, which has the church updates, the upcoming events, the happenings of the week, sermon updates, and also the birthdays of whoever is celebrating the birthday in the next 2 weeks. So it's a great information where you can get all the information about the church. So if you're receiving the emails, please take time to open the email and read it. Okay? And if you're not receiving, please subscribe to it. So how do we subscribe? You can get a welcome card from Val and tick the e-news box so that we can add you to our list. And or if you have any trouble with that, just contact the church office. Okay, so, and we have a closed Facebook group. The link to join to that is also in the e-news. So follow the e-news for all the up-to-date information of the church. And all that we want is to stay connected, not just on a Sunday morning here, not just after the service. We want to stay connected through the week so that to spur each other and to encourage each other in the walk and journey of our Christian life. For those who don't know, there's a parents' room there, mother's room here. So if you want to take your kids there, you can still see from there. It's not much difference. You can make use of that room if you're not aware of it. The last Easter services were great, having full church of people and coming, having fellowship, celebrating the resurrection of our Savior. Pastor James was speaking as he spoke on the I Am series. He placed this question before us, which was personally, it was very challenging to me, and I've been pondering over it. So I would like to share that with you. What in your life are you looking at turning to be satisfied and filled? To the right place or the wrong places? So many times, quite often, we try to find the satisfaction, the things that Jesus created, that than Jesus himself. We're trying to find the bread of life in the worldly things, but Jesus is the bread of life who could eternally satisfy us, and he is the resurrection and the life. Today, Pastor James will be speaking to us from Psalm 23, and as David mentioned, let's open our Bibles and read the darling psalm, which we are all familiar with and we have heard so many times. It's a beautiful psalm, Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's spend the next few minutes praying. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of prayer where we could come together as church family before your throne of grace. Thank you for the good Father you are. Thank you for the good shepherd you are to us. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for us. Thank you for the life, the eternal life that we have in you, Lord. Father, forgive us for the times that we have turned to the worldly things to satisfy us, to find fulfillment in. Father, we pray that we will find our satisfaction from you, Lord. Help us to be filled and consumed by your power and love, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the people who are willingly serving and partaking in the life and ministry of our church. We pray for all the ministry teams here, Lord. Today, we especially pray for our hospitality team members who serve the morning tea, supper, and who serve at the cafe, and who are creating an environment for us to connect and to have fellowship after the service, Lord, and to have the deeper conversations. Lord, we also thank you and pray for the property team members, Lord, who come here on a Saturday morning or midweek to clean the facility and the gardens, to make this place a welcoming place for us to come and worship you. Lord, we also thank you for the men being men and the wisdom for women team members, Lord, as they plan the events for the year. We pray that you'll give them the wisdom and the strength and the creative ideas to touch and reach the lives of the people who would come along for these events, Father. Father, we pray for those among us who are sick, who are in pain, who are suffering, who are recovering after surgery, waiting for an appointment, or waiting for a breakthrough in their lives. Lord, in one accord this morning, we lift them to your throne of grace. We pray that they'll experience your healing power and restoration in their life, Father. We thank you for the great testimonies we hear of the people who have experienced your wonder-working power, Lord. We praise you. We thank you that you're working in our faith life through these great testimonies, Father. Father, this morning we come before you just as we are, with our weakness, with our struggles and shortcomings. We pray that your Holy Spirit will come and work in us this morning as Pastor James brings his word, Lord. Open our hearts and minds so that we'll be able to receive the word that you have in store for us. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen.
The next song we're going to sing is a new song for the church, and it's called Satisfied. It is a song that many of you may have heard on the radio and may be familiar to you, and we would encourage you to sing it if you do know it. And if you feel that you don't know it and you can't pick it up, our prayer and encouragement is that you would just meditate on the words, and that the meaning within the words may be real for you today and may just touch you in a blessed way. I invite you to stand and sing.
I have stumbled through the darkest of the valleys, and I have climbed upon the highest of the hills, and all my traveling has brought me to your fountain, and all I want is to come and drink my fill. All I want is to come and drink my fill. In your love, I've come to find a resting place. My heart, your throne. This life belongs to you and you alone. Let there be no divide. In only you may my soul be satisfied.
Good morning, Toon Gabby Baptist Church. I'm the pastor here, and my name's James, and it's great that you're here. I encourage you to open up your Bibles. We're going to need it as we come to Psalm 23. But it's wonderful today to have the kids sitting in with us. I think it's a wonderful thing that they sit there. Don't be worried. It's actually really good for kids to see what it is that we do on a Sunday. And it's amazing how God's Word changes our lives and the impact it can have on them as well. Let me pray as we come to this psalm this morning. Father God, we thank you that you've given us your word, that you've given us the psalms that speak about the realities of life, the rawness and the realness, but they also speak about who you are. And this morning, Father, we pray that we'll have confidence in you, not in ourselves, but maybe we'll be reminded of who you are and what you're doing. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we're looking at Psalm 23. It's a psalm of confidence. But confidence can be shattered in a moment. You can be confident in yourself, but yet your circumstances in an instant can change how you feel about what you're going through. I've been watching on Netflix. I've been watching F1, Formula One. It's motor racing. I've been watching a show. And you watch these top 20 blokes in the world who can race cars at phenomenal speed, and you see how confident they are, and yet, in an instant, they can lose such confidence and it affects everything in their life. But as you see the interviews, as we think about life, I wonder, have you heard that expression, believe in yourself? I hear the racing car drivers, believe in yourself, and life will be good. If only you could believe more in yourself, you can affect your destiny. If you believe in yourself more, you can be more confident in life. That statement, believing in yourself, it feels like it does empower you. It feels in a way that if you do it, it does give you confidence. But yet, what do you do when you have believed in yourself and your world does fall down around you? Because confidence in a moment can go like that. You can be on the mountaintop and next thing be in the valley. You know, what happens if you hear it and you go, actually, my marriage is in an absolute mess. And you say, believe in myself. You're here this morning and you're unemployed. It's COVID. And if only I believe in myself more, I'm surely there's more things I can do so I am employable. And you're sitting here feeling like I can't even pay my mortgage. And I'm trying. And yet my circumstances aren't changing. You could be here and you're young parents and you've got a two-year-old and you're just so tired and exhausted from the sleepless nights. You think, believe in myself, have confidence in myself. It's actually detrimental, isn't it? We can easily be sitting here. You might be sitting here thinking, if only I could get a sermon of 5 points so I don't doubt. 7 points so that I can have an effective and wonderful marriage. And you go away and you put those 5 points into practice and you come back and you go, actually, it's had no effect. My marriage is still in a mess. I go away and you say, do these things, and yet I still go away and I'm still doubting. There's a real rawness and reality to life. And the Psalms speak about that reality. They speak about how raw life is. It talks about how real it is, that it's actually like a roller coaster ride where we have those mountaintop experiences where we can rejoice. But actually, the Psalter is real. It talks about the moments where we can't rejoice. Where there's a moment in Psalm 88, at the end, the Psalm says, my closest friend is darkness. What do you do with that when people say, believe in yourself? But we come to a Psalm today, Psalm 23, that's probably one of the most famous Psalms ever. Whether you're a Christian or not, movies quote it. People have it at their weddings, they have it at their funerals. A couple of weeks ago, I was in a car with an Uber driver, and guess what he had tattooed across his arm, and I was able to speak to him. He had, the Lord is my shepherd. We know this psalm so well. This is a psalm of confidence, but it's not a psalm of you walking away from here having to gain more confidence. It's not a passage that's going to tell you, here, go away so that you can be more confident in life. But actually, it's a psalm that tells us why we can be confident. There's a difference. There is a difference. This is a psalm that is actually all about God. Verse 1 starts with Yahweh, the Lord. Verse 6, it ends with the Lord. From beginning to end, it's actually all about God. And it's actually going to tell us why King David can have confidence in God through the trials and through the suffering. And so that we can go, why can we have confidence in God through the darkest valleys? And that's what we're going to be looking at this morning. And why is that? I've got 6 reasons. Because the first one is, the Lord is my shepherd. Have a look there at verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. Shepherd, my shepherd. It's relational, it's intimacy, it's pictures. I love it when my boys, they come and they'll sit down in the lounge and lean into me and they just share everything about their day. There's intimacy there. My shepherd, a shepherd knows his sheep by name. Now, in Australia today, we don't have names for our sheep. We don't know them individually. But when Psalm 23 was written, shepherds knew their sheep by name. They cared for them. They protected them. There was a relationship with them. And he says, the Lord is my shepherd. But who is the shepherd? It's verse 1, isn't it? The Lord, it's Yahweh. He's my shepherd. Wow. Yahweh, who in the beginning created the heavens and the earth. Place the earth in its orbit at the right spot so that it spins and life can be. Yahweh, who spoke the stars and he knows them by name. You know, if you hopped in your car today and traveled at 110 k's an hour, it would take you over 13,000 years to cross the Milky Way. There's over 100 billion stars in our galaxy. And scientists say there's over 50 billion galaxies in the universe. And King David says, the one who created, that's my shepherd. The one who created, the one who spoke to Moses in the burning bush, Yahweh, who rescued his people out of oppression and slavery, who parted the Red Sea. This is my shepherd. It's an image of provision and care. But this is King David, he's in the Old Testament. So can we say the same, the Lord is my shepherd? Well, in John chapter 10, it says, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. And so if you're in Christ today, this is our psalm. But secondly, the Lord is my shepherd, but secondly, he is also the Lord who is my contentment. If only, do you ever ask that question? If only my kids had a better education. If only I had a better house. If only I had a better car. If only I had better health. If only I got to the doctors earlier. That if only question is a contentment question. If only I have those things, then I would be content. Maybe you're thinking, as a Christian, I follow Jesus. And you go, as I look around at all my friends and work colleagues and friends at school, you go, man, look what I'm missing out on. If only. But here, the psalmist David, he says he's my contentment. It's the source of contentment. He's content in Yahweh. Have a look there at verse 1. I lack nothing. I read about a young girl who misquoted the psalm. She said, the Lord is my shepherd. That's all I want. In a way, she's getting it right. Like saying, that's all I want. That's where contentment is found. I lack nothing. But I want you to have a look now in verses 2. When you have a look at verse 2, I want you to have a look at who the subject of the verbs are. It's not us. It's Yahweh. It's God, the Lord. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures. The Lord leads me beside quiet waters. It's a picture of contentment. A couple of years ago, I was traveling up to Queensland, to Goondiwindi, to stay the night, and it was mid-drought. The New South Wales is in drought. And as I was driving through Narrabri and we're heading up to Goondiwindi, as I looked out our window at the bare paddocks, I saw sheep walking. They were in a line and they walked and they were walking. Every paddock I drove past, I love looking around as I drive. And you just see them walking everywhere. When I was traveling to Goondiwindi that afternoon, I didn't see any sheep laying down. Why? Because sheep actually only lay down when they're content. If they're not feeling safe, they're not going to lie down. If they don't have a full stomach, they're not going to lie down. See, the picture here is a picture of contentment. Sheep only lie down when they are content. The Lord is my contentment. See, the shepherd knows. See, a shepherd knows what the sheep need. A shepherd cares for the sheep. The shepherd knows what they need in that right moment. I wonder, have you ever thought to yourself that we know best? I know what's best for me in this situation right now, and right in this moment, here is not the best place to be. What I'm going through right now isn't the place I should be. I should be somewhere else. You might be thinking, man, I'm here living in Toongabby because my wife got a job. If only my wife didn't get a job here, I wouldn't have to live here. We could be living at the coast somewhere on the beach, enjoying the sunshine and the surf. If only. Or maybe you're a young family and you've got like 5 kids under 6 and you're like, your eyes are just bleh. You're tired, you're exhausted, and you've got matchsticks holding them up, and you think to yourself, this is not where God wants me right now. I want to be doing all these other wonderful things, but surely God, this is not where I'm meant to be. It's like we think that God didn't know we're going to have 5-year-olds and 4-year-olds and 2-year-olds. We are where we're meant to be. He knows what we need. We are where God wants us. I lack nothing, says David, because Yahweh, he's my contentment who leads, who guides, and who lies me down. So why can David have confidence in God? Why is his confidence in God through trials and the seasons of life? Why can we too? Because the Lord is my shepherd, who's my contentment, but also is the one who gives life. Look at verse 3. He refreshes. It's in a way he brings back to life. He gives life. But he also guides me along the right paths. Or maybe you know it as he leads you along the path of righteousness. But what it's conveying here is he guides us along the right path. He guides us along it. He gives life to us. But you might be asking here today, well, yeah, that's good. He guides us, he leads us. But how does he lead us? Is it just a feeling that we get inside? A right feeling or a wrong feeling? How do we know when it's a right and a wrong feeling? Is it just some sort of mysticism that we think, okay, if we're spiritual enough, we'll know where we're meant to go? Is it an open and a closed door kind of thing? Is that the kind of leading along the right path that we're meant to think about when God leads us through the right paths? Actually, how does God lead us? He leads us in his word. He leads us through his word. That's how he leads us. Psalms tells us that. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to the path. See, how do we know? How does God lead us? He actually leads us in his word. And so here at Toongabie Baptist Church, we want to be people who are deep in the word. Because to know how to be led, we need to be deep in the word. We need to be realigned. We need to be corrected all the time. We want to be a church that's deep in the word in life groups. We want to be deep in the word on a Sunday morning because it actually matters. Deep in the word. But number 4, the Lord is my shepherd who is with me. So the Lord, his contentment, he gives life, but he's also the Lord who is with me. Have you ever thought to yourself, I thought if I just followed Jesus, it would all be chocolate and roses? Have you ever had, maybe you've heard a preacher say, once you follow Jesus, your life's just going to be a lot better. You should expect big things from God. You should expect a blessed life. Your money should improve. Your marriage should improve. All these things should just get better. And if it's not, there's a problem. That if you're in a dark valley, obviously God's not with you in that. If what you're going through right now is so terrible, you think, how could God allow me to go through that? Surely it was meant to be roses and chocolate. And so if it's not roses and chocolate, I've done something wrong and I shouldn't be here. And obviously God is not with me through this. Look at verse 4. Notice verse 4 doesn't say if or maybe. It's even though I walk, it's going to happen. There's going to be those mountaintop experiences where you look out of Mount Everest and you go, wow, life is great. But there's also going to be moments that even though I walk through the darkest valley, some of you may know this as you walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I think the conveyance here of walking through the darkest valley is really helpful. It's when you walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. Why? Have a look there. It tells us, for you are with me. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, your comforts, and it pulls me back. It encourages me. But even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. See, in the ancient world, cities were built on mountaintops. They were built on the higher ridges like a city on a hill. So you could see them, but they're a place of safety and protection. They are a good place to be, mountaintop experiences. But in the ancient world, it was in the valleys that were the dark places. Many of us go to valleys today because they're beautiful and wonderful, and we go, you like canyoning, you like doing those things. And to go into a valley is actually quite a safe and a wonderful place to be, but not in the ancient world. A valley was a dark place. It was an evil place. It was a place where you could get robbed. It's a place where the sun may not come through the valley. There may be no light of day there. It was a place you wouldn't want to go. And yet, even though I go through the darkest valley, Yahweh, you are with me. For you are with me. Now, I wonder if you've picked up the shift in language here in this verse. There's a shift. See, in the opening verses, King David, he's speaking to the crowd. He's speaking to those around him. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads me. He guides me. He lies me down. And then we get to the dark valley. Right, he's speaking to the crowd, but now the moment he steps foot in the darkest valley, his focus swaps from talking to them to going, you are with me. As you read the Psalms, you need to watch the language. You need to watch the third and the second person in English. He is a third person and you is a second person. Here in the opening verse, it's speaking and now it shifts. I step into this dark valley, but you are with me, Yahweh. You are with me in this. God is with us in the light. And he does not leave us in the dark. He is right there with you. I never imagined digging the grave of my own daughter, this author writes. The day of her funeral was cold and rainy. It seemed appropriate for what we were doing. They were missionaries overseas. My wife, daughter and I were driven far up into a mountain by a friend and his family. The place was remote. We couldn't see the horizon in any direction. All we could see was the top of the dirt road we drove up, and no one else was in sight. And with my friend's shovel, we dug a grave. He and I were taking turns. The dig was solemn and silent, and the ground was soft with rain. I couldn't help but think about the missionary John G. Patton, who buried his wife and child with his own bare hands, both of his loved ones dying young. I thought that stories of digging graves for loved ones were only for missionaries from centuries ago. Things like that didn't happen anymore, but I was wrong. That very thing was happening to me. With the grave dug and struggling through the tears, I said some words about our small daughter, giving thanks to God for her life. Then we had some prayer time together. We lowered her casket into the grave. I filled her grave with dirt. We put a flower and a rock on top of the gravesite. It's a gravesite we could never find again, even if we wanted to. And my repeated thought was, is this really happening to me? The dark valley. And some of you know that dark valley. You've been there, burying a parent or burying a child. You know that real rawness of walking through the valley of darkness. For the Lord is my shepherd, who is with us in that valley. See, King David, he's walked that valley. He buried a son. He had another son turn against him and want to take his throne from him. But not only did he battle that dark valley, he also would have had an internal dark battle, coming to face with the reality that he was a liar. He was an adulterer. He was a murderer as well. He walked the dark valley. And maybe some of you here today have been walking that valley. Or maybe you're walking another internal battle, another dark valley. You're walking that path of mental health. Maybe you're walking the path of depression. Or maybe you're walking that path of anxiety. Or maybe there's just that old addiction that you've been addicted to in the past that keeps rearing its ugly head. If you're in Christ, Yahweh is with you. The Lord is with you in that. So you might be here and maybe the depression is so overwhelming right now that as you're turning inward, you think to yourself, I'm alone. Maybe you're right now and you're actually not feeling it. Maybe you're not experiencing it. Maybe you're not feeling, you're going, oh God, you're not with me. I don't feel it. Psalm 23 says, He's with you, even if you don't feel it. Even if you don't feel it. The Lord is my shepherd who is with me. But He's also the Lord is my shepherd who protects me. See, this rod and this staff, it moves. This imagery flows down into verse 5. Have a look at verse 5. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. That's a picture, this cup that overflows is a picture of abundance, but He's the one who protects me. When I was living in Forbes, I'd walk around the lake. There was a lake there, it was actually a swamp, and you'd walk around it. It's about 4K, you could do a 4K journey, you could do a 10K journey, whatever you want. And every week I'd often walk around it and pray and think about the passage we're going to preach on that Sunday. But around autumn and around spring, as you'd walk around this lake, because it's a swamp, it stinks and it's horrible. There's carp, there's fish, there's turtles. And turtles in the warmth, they'd come up to the water. And they'd come and they'd sit on a stick. And they'd sit there exposed to the elements. So they'd sit there bathing in the sun. And I'd imagine as an insect flew past, they'd probably reach out and grab it. Sitting there in the sun and the warmth, and yet exposed. And you'd walk past and boom, guess what happens? They're scared, they run off. And I remember this one day, it was a Thursday afternoon, and I'm walking around the lake over this bridge, and just off in the scenery, there's about 8 turtles sitting on this one log, exposed. They didn't know I was there. And as I walk closer, and as soon as one saw me, see, I'm the enemy to them. And as soon as they saw me, all of them, kamikaze roll into the water and off they went. They went and sought protection in the water. See, here this is speaking of protection. See, in the ancient world, and even today, flies annoy sheep. Flies can actually kill sheep. Flies and wool and moisture don't go well together. Flies like to lay eggs and the maggots get in there and they overwhelm the sheep and eventually it'll poison the sheep if you don't treat it and they will be dead. And so what do farmers do today? They spray them to protect them from the flies. Now in the ancient world, they didn't have the same chemicals. But what would they do? They would put oil on the head of the sheep to protect it. To protect it from flies. But not only that, a shepherd also protects the sheep. See, foxes and wolves, they'll attack at night. They'll attack when there's no one else around. But if the shepherd is standing in the field with the sheep, guess what happens? Foxes will just sort of wander around the outside and they won't attack because the shepherd is there with the sheep. And so what we're getting a picture of in verse 5 is we're getting a picture of this banquet where the sheep are sitting there with the shepherd, exposed, sitting in a 100-acre paddock in the sunshine, enjoying the sun, while the enemy looks on. The enemy can't come any closer. They can't attack because the shepherd's there. They look on and they look on from the outside. They can gnarl, they can bark, they can go, I want them, I want to devour them. They can snarl at us. They can snicker at us. They can ridicule us. They can laugh at us. As Christians, we can have people who ridicule and laugh at us and look on from the outside, but they cannot touch us because the shepherd is our protection. The shepherd says, eat. It's okay. It's a bit of a beautiful picture, isn't it, of a banquet with the king. And no one else can come. The enemies are outside. It's an overflow of abundance. The cup that overflows, it's an idea of also welcoming. We are welcome at the shepherd's table. Isn't that a beautiful picture of the gospel? We were once enemies. We were the enemies on the outside. We were in our sin, dead in our sins, enemies of God. And yet through the good shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep, we could come and sit at his table. We did nothing for that. Christ did it all. And so why can David have confidence in God? Why through the seasons and the trials and the dark valleys we can have confidence? It's because the Lord protects us. But finally, the Lord is my shepherd who pursues me relentlessly. He pursues me relentlessly. Pride is dangerous. Pride gets in the road. Pride tells us you are confident in yourself, doesn't it? Pride actually makes us feel confident. I'm a pretty good bloke. I'm pretty capable of this situation. And so you go in confident. You can go on the sporting field confident because you know in your pride and your arrogance, you know you're actually better than everyone else. And so you go in with confidence and you win. Pride gets in the road. But look at verse 6. Surely, I think sometimes we read this verse wrong because of pride. Verse 6, surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I will dwell in God's presence. Now, here, the forever here is David's talking about this life. For as long as my days are. But surely your goodness and your love will follow me. Now, that word follow there, it gives us a picture of a kid just following a dog down the street. Or a younger brother who's following an older brother as they walk around or they play soccer. But the language of follow here isn't that kind of follow. It's actually the language of pursue. It's actually the language of pursue relentlessly. This isn't they're following you because there's something good in you. God pursues you. It's pursue relentlessly. No matter what road you have gone down, God will pursue his sheep. See, it's not that God's on your tail looking back and you've got to look back and he's on your tail and there's wrath and judgment following you. No, it's actually goodness and love is pursuing you. The goodness is God. The love is God. This word for kindness or love is this Old Testament language of hesed love. This is hesed love. It's love for his people that he's in covenant relationship with. It's a love that is never ending, eternal. It's love despite our failures, despite our stuff ups. God still loves us. It's unconditional love. It's the kind of love that Yahweh uses to express his love for his people. People who he's made a covenant to, people he's made a promise to. He says, I love you eternally. I've made these promises and they're going to come through. because that's who he is. He's Hesed love. It's in his character. Why does he do this? Why does he do it? Verse 3 tells us. He does it for his name's sake. He actually does it for his glory. He's actually doing it for his character. See, there is nothing good in you for him to pursue you. We can't sit here this morning and go, I'm such a confident person, that's why goodness and mercy follow me. No, 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 the reason is because it's actually the character of God. It's actually for his glory and his renown. It's Hesed love, covenant love. And I reckon if I was to talk to you, some of you can testify to this, that God pursued you down. That God put people, he put people and places in your path. He put life circumstances in your life so that you would see the Good Shepherd. Whether it was in the darkest valley where you had nowhere else to turn, or whether it was a Nathan that God used to rebuke David, that he used someone in your life to rebuke you. God uses someone, or he's used places to pursue you. The shepherd pursues his sheep. We see that in the New Testament in Matthew chapter 18, where the shepherd leaves the 99 to find the one, to find the lost. Kirsten Powers was a very successful businesswoman in the US. She was a commentator and journalist. But she also was, she would say, either an atheist or an agnostic. And she would say her Christian friends would come up to her and say, I can't believe you don't know Jesus. Like, why wouldn't you want to know Jesus? How terrible your life must be because you don't know Jesus. And she just thought to herself, she thought, you're joking, right? My life is actually pretty good. You don't know my life. It's actually really good. You're crazy. Eric Metaxas one day said, I think you should join a Bible study. And she's like, oh, yeah. Because what had happened, her boyfriend had come home one night and he said to her, he said, oh, I've got something to tell you. I've become a Christian. She's like, oh, no. And he did what she would do. He said, could you at least keep an open mind about this? And to her, an agnostic and an atheist and a progressive, she thought, keep an open mind. That's what I tell you. You need to keep an open mind about this matter. And he said to her, you keep an open mind about this matter. And so later on, Eric Metaxas talks to her and says, why don't you come and join a Bible study? And she goes to this Bible study. I remember walking into that Bible study and I had a knot in my stomach, and in my mind, only weirdos and zealots went to Bible studies. I don't remember what was said that day. All I know is when I left, everything had changed. I'll never forget standing outside that apartment on the Upper East Side and saying to myself, it's true. It's completely true. The world looked entirely different. Like a veil had been lifted off. I had not an iota of doubt, and I was filled with indescribable joy. But the horror of the prospect of being a devout Christian crept back in almost immediately. I spent the next couple of months doing my best to wrestle away from God, to try to get away from God. It was pointless. Everywhere I turned, there he was. Slowly there was less fear and more joy. The hound of heaven had pursued me and caught me, whether I liked it or not. The shepherd pursues and will hold his promises. Even though my strength may fail, he will hold me fast. See, it's not about you holding on tight, but that he'll hold on tight. He will pursue you because of his name and his character. Goodness and kindness will pursue you with all my days, say Yahweh. In Romans, we get a picture of that as well. I'm going to just read to you Romans chapter 8. Turn to Romans chapter 8 if you want. Turn to Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus who died. More than that, who was raised to life. Is it at the right hand of who is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardships or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we will face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither the height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The Lord is my shepherd who relentlessly pursues us, who protects us, who's with us, who gives us life. What hope, what confidence that gives us, not in ourselves, but in the shepherd. Because see, if Jesus is your shepherd, this is your psalm. This is a psalm that you can speak. This is a psalm that you can tell others. This is a psalm because the Lord is my shepherd, because Christ is my shepherd. Hold on to it. Delight in it. But if Jesus isn't your shepherd today, Psalm 23 isn't your psalm. The words of the psalm aren't real for you. But for this to be your psalm, Jesus needs to become your shepherd. And if that's you and you go, I want this kind of contentment. I want confidence outside myself. Or you know that you're in this darkest valley right now and you're alone. And you want the truth of this psalm, Jesus says, come to me, all who are wearied and heavy laden. Come to him today and trust in him. Come and trust in the shepherd who laid his life down for the sheep. See, if Christ is your good shepherd, why can we have confidence to face the trials and the seasons of life? Because Christ is in us. We have confidence to face it because of Christ. Why? Because Jesus, he went through the darkest valley alone, where he cried out on the cross, Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? He went through the darkest valley alone so that you and me would never have to go through the darkest valley alone again, because he is with us. He's our good shepherd. The Lord is our shepherd. Let's pray. Father, as we go through the seasons and the toils of life, what confidence is to know that you are with us, that the Lord is our shepherd. We lack nothing. Father, may that just be etched into our hearts today. May it soothe and comfort us. And Lord, I pray for those who are really in that dark valley right now, who go, actually, I don't feel anything. Lord, I pray that they will know. Lord, may they know that you are with them even though they don't feel it. Father, how good it is that you are our shepherd. And Father, we are eternally thankful for that. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor James, and we hope that you were moved and felt God talking to you through that sermon. And we invite you now to stand and sing praises to the Lord our God, who is ever faithful to us, ever relentless in his pursuit over us. Amen.
Reminder and encouragement this morning that our confidence and trust comes from the Lord my shepherd, who is my contentment, who is with me, who gives me life, and he pursues me relentlessly. This word relentlessly breaks me. He wouldn't stop. He would do anything to get me notice him and to love him. So let's go into this week with that confidence and trust that comes from the Lord alone, not with the self-confidence, not with our pride, not with my abilities. Let's go into the week with that confidence. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week.